This presentation covers three jazz musicians from New Orleans who were operating at the beginning of jazz history.
Jelly Roll Morton,
Sidney Bechet,
and Louis Armstrong.
Though there were many similarities between the three, they were each a different kind of jazz musician. Morton was a pianist singer who composed jazz music. Bechet was a clarinetist saxophonist who improvised jazz music. And Armstrong was a trumpeter singer who renovated jazz music. They also differed in their abilities to read and write music. Morton was literate, Armstrong was semi-literate, and Bechet was completely illiterate. Note, I'm talking about reading and writing, not playing. Armstrong could arguably play music better than either Morton or Bechet. They were alike in at least one way, though. While most New Orleans musicians played rags, popular songs, and waltzes, Morton, Bechet, and Armstrong played hot music that was unmistakably jazz. The rest of this presentation inspects some details about each man's life and summarizes their contribution to jazz music.
Jelly Roll Morton.
I have been robbed of $3 million all told. Everyone today is playing my stuff and I don't even get credit. Kansas City style, Chicago style, New Orleans style, hell, they're all Jelly Roll style.
Jelly Roll Morton, 1890 to 1941, is considered the first jazz composer of any consequence. He was one of the first jazz musicians to write down his music, and his compositions were the first to fully exploit the New Orleans sound.
Morton significantly improved the jazz style by suffusing his music with proper chord progressions, voice leading, and arrangement.
Morton's instrumental parts were superb because they exploited all the existing tricks of the style: gruff timbres, syncopated rhythms, stop time, improvisation, blues, etc. In the realm of early jazz arrangements, Jelly Roll Morton was peerless. He began playing piano in the brothels and saloons of Storyville as a teenager. Morton described the area to archivist Alan Lomax in a 1939 interview as follows.
Music was pouring into the streets from every house. Women were standing in the doorway, singing or chanting some kind of blues, some very happy, some very sad, some with the desire to end it all by poison, some planning a big outing, a dance, or some other kind of enjoyment.
His grandmother kicked him out of the house for his new job in Storyville. Her opinion was that, quote, a musician was nothing but a bum and a scalawag, close quote. Morton moved around extensively and became a con man, an opportunist, and a pimp that incidentally also worked as a pianist. Music eventually won out, and Morton settled in Chicago about 1923. There he gained an audience for his jazz music, began publishing his compositions, and started making records. Morton's output was primarily comprised of piano solos, band arrangements, and vocal accompaniments. His recording outfit was known as Jelly Roll Morton and his Red Hot Peppers. Some of Morton's songs were published as print music, recorded as piano solos, and recorded as band arrangements. Such was the case for the song Original Jelly Roll Blues. He published the song in 1917, recorded a piano version in 1924, and recorded a band arrangement in 1926. Here's the band arrangement. Morton had a contract with Victor Records and became rich and successful. But contract disputes, a stylistic shift away from New Orleans jazz, and the Great Depression destroyed his career. He died 2 years after sustaining a knife wound to the chest in a 1938 dispute with a club owner's friend in Washington, D.C. He moved to Los Angeles in hopes the weather there would improve his health. But he never recovered from the knife attack, and he died in July of 1941. By then, he was poor and largely forgotten. Morton had an incisive and self-centered quality about him and would often brag about how he had invented this or how he had been the first to do that. Despite this megalomaniacal attitude, Morton was reported to have been a kind and decent man who made a habit of sending money home to his two sisters all through his working life. Despite his kindness, Morton selfishly claimed he'd invented jazz and stomps and said that cornetist Buddy Bolden had only been playing ragtime. Morton had not invented jazz, but he did make substantial contributions to the style's development. He is, therefore, one of the most influential figures in early jazz history. Sidney Bechet.
There were so many fine musicianers around New Orleans then, so much a man could learn from, but I was getting restless.
Sidney Bechet, 1897 to 1959, was born in New Orleans to a musical family. He learned the clarinet as a preteen by ear, and he started playing soprano saxophone when he was in his early 20s. Bechet is regarded as the first truly great improviser in jazz history. Bechet is unusual in that he spent much of his career touring Europe. He is, therefore, one of the primary reasons why jazz became an international phenomenon in the 1920s. Bechet steadfastly pursued performance opportunities around town, and by 15, he was playing with the most audacious hot music band around, Willie Bunk Johnson's Eagle Orchestra. By the time he was 20, Bechet had procured an opportunity to perform in Europe as part of Clarence Williams' Blue Five. A Swedish conductor named Ernest Ansermet, commenting on a performance from this tour, wrote that, quote, Bechet was the first of his race to have composed perfectly formed blues on the clarinet, close quote. Bechet was Creole. Thus, he was not connected to the blues the same way African Americans were. Nevertheless, Bechet understood and communicated the blues perfectly. When Bechet returned home from the tour of Europe, he was immediately hired by a young Duke Ellington. However, Bechet did not last long with Ellington because Bechet thought of himself as an independent agent and not as a member of a band. In addition to his fierce independence, Bechet also had a tempestuous attitude that would get him in trouble from time to time. Bechet got arrested in Paris when he injured a woman during a shootout. The dispute was with a musician who claimed Bechet played the wrong chords. Because he spent so much time in Europe throughout his career, Bechet is somewhat underrepresented on record. One of his best is a remarkable track cut with Louis Armstrong in 1924 called Cakewalkin' Babies. Bechet had a lengthy career and was still making records and giving performances in the 1950s. He died of lung cancer on his 62nd birthday in 1959. Louis Armstrong.
Man, if you gotta ask, you'll never know.
Louis Armstrong, 1901 to 1971, was the most consequential figure in all jazz history. Although he is the youngest musician to be considered here, he managed to exert a massive influence on Morton and Bechet. Along with countless other veteran musicians, Morton and Bechet had to adjust their playing to match his, just like every other jazz musician. They had to change. It was the only way to maintain relevance. Morton was less successful at changing than Bechet, and consequently had a less lucrative career than Bechet. And neither musician had anything like Armstrong's success. According to jazz historian Gary Giddens and Scott DeVoe, Armstrong's massive influence on jazz can be summarized into five categories. 1. Blues, 2. Improvisation, 3. Singing, 4. Repertoire, and 5. Rhythm. Armstrong codified the sound of the blues by infusing his solos with blues scales, blues notes, and other blues conventions. Improvisation became ascendant under Armstrong's stewardship because he imbued everything he produced with some extemporaneous playing, because his command of that form of expression was unprecedented. Armstrong influenced generations of singers by being the first to record scat singing, a technique that employs nonsense syllables and partial words to carry a tune. Jazz repertoire was hugely influenced by the types of songs Armstrong chose to play, which included all styles and genres. His song selection included everything from Tin Pan Alley to traditional folk. Armstrong introduced jazz rhythms into American culture through the vehicle of the pop song. One way to put it is that he taught the country to swing. These five attributes are on display in Armstrong's audio recordings, made between 1925 and 1929 by OK Records in Chicago. There were 65 tracks made for OK, and they all feature small ensembles centered on Armstrong. These pickup groups, which were composed of studio musicians and friends, were called the Hot Five or the Hot Seven, depending on how many musicians were in the studio for the session. The original Hot Fives of late 1925 featured Armstrong on trumpet and vocals, Johnny Dodds on clarinet, Kid Ory on trombone, Johnny St. Cyr on banjo, and Armstrong's wife, Lil Armstrong, on piano. The Hot Five and Hot Seven recordings changed jazz history because they forcefully introduced Armstrong's revisionist attitude towards jazz. Here's how Gary Giddens puts the power of the Hot Five and Hot Seven recordings in his 1998 book, Visions of Jazz, The First Century. Quote, "In the relative privacy of Chicago's OK Studio, Armstrong directed a measured yet rapid assault on jazz practices, supplanting group embellishment with solo improvisation, 2- and 4-bar breaks with entire ad-lib choruses, and the multiple refrains of ragtime with theme and variations patterned on the blues and songs." Close quote. The first confirmed by the critics masterpiece in the jazz tradition is Armstrong's 1928 recording of West End Blues. This recording features all the contributions made by Armstrong to jazz music. He scats, he swings, he plays the blues, he's the focus instead of the song, and he improvises.
The melodic figure he improvises at the top of West End Blues embarrasses the ordinary human imagination for melody.
Here is Giddens commenting on this musical figure. Quote, "West End Blues begins with a clarion call to arms, a bewitching, fantastical, rhythmically headlong cadenza. Armstrong was supremely successful throughout his career, and he made a full transition from jazz musician to pop star. The music Armstrong played towards the end of his career was less brilliant and much less consequential to jazz than the music he played near the beginning. But Armstrong's early efforts produced the finest music that exists in the entire tradition. A few things should be clear when thinking about New Orleans jazz
and the three men discussed in this presentation.
New Orleans jazz is sometimes called Dixieland. Jelly Roll Morton codified the jazz style by writing it down. Sidney Bechet spread jazz to an international audience by performing in Europe. Louis Armstrong reconfigured jazz by focusing his music on improvisation and solos instead of ensembles and songs. Morton and Bechet were megalomaniacs who were in love with themselves. Armstrong knew he was good, but was generally humble.
The chronology of influential New Orleans jazzmen goes like this.
Buddy Bolden, Jelly Roll Morton, Joe King Oliver, Sidney Bechet, and Louis Armstrong.